All right. Yeah, well, you should be fine. Pat's usually the one doing this. So Jesus is for the Old Testament.
policies and I'm not gonna read all 300, but these two are, I think, are very specific and I'll explain them to you. This one's from the Book of Wisdom, which was written in the first century BC. And one thing that skeptics try to do is say, well, these prophecies were written after Jesus lived, and they went back and added them or created these prophecies in the Old Testament. The problem with that is that most of the Old Testament was in its completed form as we have it now by the 5th century BC or 6th century BC, and then other parts of it about a century later. So these scriptures were written decades, hundreds of years before Jesus lived. So he fulfilled these prophecies, and you can't find a natural explanation for how specific they are. So this one says, let us find way in the righteous one, because he is annoying to us. He opposes our actions, reproaches us for transgressions of the law, and charges us with the violation of our training. He professes to have knowledge of God and styles himself a child of the Lord. To us, he is the censure of our thoughts. Merely to see him is a hardship for us, because his life is not like that of others, and different are his ways. He judges us debased. He holds aloof from our paths as from things impure. He calls blessed the destiny of the righteous and boasts that God is his father. That's something no Jew would ever do. Let us see whether his words be true. Let us find out what will happen to him at the end. For if the righteous one is the Son of God, God will help him and deliver him from the hand of his foes. With violence and torture let us put him to test, that we may have proof of his gentleness and try his patience. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for according to his own words, God will take care of him. So this, who, what group of people in the Jewish culture at the time did not like Jesus, and he got on their nerves really bad? Who, anybody know? The Pharisees, you have religious leadership too, because he saw their hypocrisy, he would confront them on that, they didn't like him. And of course they conspired to have him crucified during his passion. But the next one is Psalm 22. My God, why have you abandoned me? But I am a worm, not a man, scorned by men, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They curl their lips and jeer. They shake their heads at me. He relied on the Lord. Let him deliver him. If he loves him, let him rescue him. Many bulls surround me. Fierce bulls of Bashan encircle me. They open their mouths against me. Lions their grin and roar. Like water, my life drains away. All my bones are disjointed. My heart has become like wax. But it melts away within me. As dry as a potsherd is my throat, my tongue cleaves to my palate. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me, a pack of evildoers closes in on me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They stare at me and gloat. They divide my garments among them, for my clothing they cast lots. Every detail of this was fulfilled in his crucifixion. His hands and feet were pierced. Remember the Roman soldiers that were familiar with the passion story? They cast lots for his clothing. And people jeered and mocked him. And the thing is, Jesus quotes this psalm from the cross. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And a lot of people think that he was probably scared. But what he's doing is, he's using a biblical teaching method, which was to quote the first few words of the psalm to direct the students to that psalm. That's what he's doing. He's quoting Psalm 22 to show he's fulfilling the psalm, but it also has an opportunity. It's not just about the death of Jesus, it's also which she talked last week about all of Adam and Eve. And then she says, but remember, there's a promise right in the very beginning. Chapter 3 is when they fall. But then God says, you know, he gets a fucking, everyone gets punishment. And he says to the serpent, I will put an enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So this is the very first prophecy of Jesus, of the Messiah. We're going to break down the meaning of this passage, because you have to understand a little bit about the culture and language and the whole meaning. So when it talks about cursing, in Semitic culture, the seed was never from the woman, it was from the man. The seed was the seed of the man. And so this prophecy saying the seed of the woman is pointing to the virginal conception of Jesus. He had no earthly father. It was a miraculous conception by the Holy Spirit. And he had only the biological mother, not the biological father. The enmity between you and the woman, enmity is total opposition. And between you and the woman, and this is pointing to Mary's Immaculate Conception, and we are going to have a session just on Marian teaching, so don't worry, you know, don't worry about this, but I'm just showing this goes back to the very beginning, and that one of the consequences of original sin is that Camille talked about this to some degree, the man weakened nature, really inclined towards doing the wrong thing. We'll choose the wrong thing, thinking it's good for us because our intellects are darkened. We're confused because of our fallen nature. We're easily deceived, led astray. And so we'll choose a bad thing, thinking it's good for us. So Mary was never in that position. God created her in a state of grace, just the way Adam and Eve were created. She didn't have original sin. And it was for this reason, for she was prayer her being the mother of God, and she would be a complete, total enemy to Satan. She was never under his dominion, which we are to a degree because of original sin. And then it says, he shall bruise your head. Jesus will strike a definitive, destructive blow to Satan. But Satan will also injure Jesus. He will kill Jesus, and the grief starting with people against him. But Jesus will rise again. So there's a lot packed in that building. Any questions? So Golgotha, this is mentioned in three Gospels, John, Mark, and Matthew. When I first started reading of the New Testament, I wonder why did they mention that? And it means place of the soul. And Jesus is going to crush the head of Satan. Satan is a fallen angel. He doesn't have a physical body. He doesn't have a physical head to crush. But this is when Jesus defeated Satan was on the cross. When Jesus offered his life to the Father for our sins, that was destructive blow to Satan. Satan no longer had the power that he had before, because Jesus had won. He redeemed us. And so now we have hope of salvation. We've been redeemed. So this is the meaning of Golgotha. There's a symbolic meaning there, pointing to the fact that this is where Jesus crushes the head of Satan. So going back to the promises, Abraham is he's one of the patriarchs. The promise God gives him, which was written in the scripture, Mark and Harry, was the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your land, your relatives, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and curse those who curse you. All the families of the earth will find blessing in you. And that was the calling of the Israelites, who were all descended physically from Abram, who became Abraham. And God changes his name. Abram means exalted father. Abraham means father of many. And when God changes somebody's name, when we see in salvation history in the Bible, that's because they have a special role to fulfill. And this is Abraham's role, is he's going to be the spiritual and biological wife and the children until, I believe Sarah was 90 years old when she got pregnant. Abraham was 100, if I'm not mistaken. So they were very old when they had Isaac. He did father a child through one of his maids. What was her name?
This one. This one. Hagar, you did it, Mark.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it. And because Sarah was getting impatient, she said, okay, just, you know, have a baby with her. And that was Ishmael. So he had two sons, but Isaac is the one that God made the covenant. The covenant was with his son by Sarah. And of course, this is ultimately fulfilled in Jesus. Jesus is the one who correctly fulfills this. And then we have Abraham for the sacrifice of Isaac, his son. And this is an image of Christ's sacrifice. I spoke before about there's things in the Old Testament that are like a foreshadowing of things in the New. And this is a picture of the sacrifice of Jesus. Because Isaac is Abraham's only son by his wife Sarah. And Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, and he's the only son of Mary. Isaac, and scholars say he was either a teenager or a young adult. Remember, Abraham is over 100 years old at this point. Isaac could have easily overpowered him or just run away from him. He knew what was going on. He wasn't stupid. He's carrying the wood. He knows what's happening. He willingly carries the wood of the sacrifice of Mount Moriah. Jesus carries the wood of the cross of Calvary, which is on Mount Moriah. This took place in the same place. Isaac is bound by Abram. He's tied up. Jesus is bound by soldiers. Isaac, like I said, is a willing sacrifice. He's not being dragged up. He's willingly, he understands what's going on, and he's offering himself in obedience to his Father. And Jesus says, open up the hand of the gospel, and lays down his life by his own accord, but what he's saying in his life. And then God provides a ram, a substitute for Isaac. There's a ram that's caught in a bush with thorns, and that's what the Abraham finds on sacrifice. And Jesus is the ram that dies for our sins. So this sacrifice, the one that didn't go through with it, but is giving us the image of God the Father sending his only son as a sacrifice. And now King David, and this is a promise. Moreover, the Lord also declares to you, David, that the Lord will make a house for you when your days have been completed and you rested your ancestors. I will raise up your offspring after you, sprung from your loins, and I will establish his kingdom. He it is who shall build a house for my name, and I will establish his royal throne forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. If he does wrong, I will reprove him with the human rod and with human punishments. But I will not withdraw my favor from him as I withdrew it from Saul. Your house and your kingdom are firm forever before me. Your throne shall be firmly established forever. Okay, that was a covenant, the sacred binding agreement God made with King David, that he would have descended, he would rule forever. So obviously this can't be exciting to a first century Jew who knew what this was about, because the two Gospels stress Jesus' genealogical descent from the house of David, neither from Joseph and biologically from Mary. Matthew's Gospel is written primarily to Jews, so his whole Gospel is kind of aimed at Jesus' fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies. And so Matthew divides Jesus' genealogy in three sets of 14. David's name adds up to 14 in Hebrew. Zerubbabel is the last Davidic descendant of Jesus of the Old Testament, but his descendants are listed in Matthew's genealogy, so they kept track of the descendants, showing that David's royal line is continuing up to the time of Jesus through his father Joseph, instead of his foster father. And so he's given the title Son of David, which again goes to that idea that he, the descendant of David, was going to be born forever. Although the Jews at that time had a little bit more as just the restoration of the earthly historical form of the kingdom, not as a spiritual kingdom. But again, you know, this is where things in the Bible, we may not understand why they're in there, but once you understand it, it makes sense. You know, again, God's given the credentials for Jesus, and he's the fulfillment of this. Now, Christ, you know, Jesus called Christ, or Jesus Christ, is the Greek word for the Hebrew word, which is Messiah, which means anointed one. And that's because the Davidic kings were anointed at the time of their coronation, and the Holy Spirit would come upon them. It indwelled them like after some baptism, but it did come upon them. And so they were all Messiahs, they were all anointed ones. Even David, when he has an opportunity, King Saul was the first king of Israel, and he turned out not to be so good. And he's actually trying to kill David because he knows that he wants to keep he wants to be king. He doesn't want anybody to take over. You know? So he's actually trying to kill David. He's hunting him down. And David at one point has a chance to kill Saul. He, you know, Saul was sleeping. He wasn't aware David was there. He could have killed him, but he said, "I dare not." Not saying a word for word, but he said, you know, somebody suggested to him, "Why don't you kill me?" He's like, "No, I can't touch the Lord's anointed." He called Saul the Lord's anointed because he had been anointed when he was made king. And even though he was a bad king, David still respected him, even though he was trying to kill him, and he was not killing him. So Jesus' baptism in the Jordan River is his anointing as a messianic king. And you see the Holy Spirit coming upon him. And just like happened with the Davidic kings, and also the Jordan River Valley represented new beginnings and new life, because that's the river they crossed over to enter the Promised Land from their 40 years of wandering. And this is the traditional baptism sign of Jesus in Jordan. My daughter took this picture a couple of years ago. It's not really on the Jordan River anymore, because the river's shrunk a lot because they're drawing water, it takes a lot of water off of it. But I asked my daughter, I said, "I don't know that Jesus was baptized there," but they actually uncovered like five churches and underneath each other, layers and layers, archaeologists have found. So there's testimony from early Christians. So this is believed to be the baptism site of Jesus. So one of the other promises is forgiveness of sins. And this, there was a poem on the poor guys. It's not in scripture. It's an ancient Passover poem that's used in the synagogue liturgy. And it says there's four events that take place on the same calendar day as the Passover. One is the creation of the universe. Two, God's covenant with Abraham. Israel's deliverance from Egypt. And the future messianic king was expected to bring redemption to the Jews, which Jesus accomplished through his passion and death during the Passover. You know, Jesus was crucified during the Passover. So this is, again, even outside of the Bible, there's this understanding of this fulfillment. And so it's forgiveness and freedom from sins, which is our major problem. So now we come to the incarnation. And the incarnation, it comes from the Latin word, which just means flesh. So this is where God, who is pure as the sand, But Jesus' existence did not begin in the incarnation, because there's three persons, and plus the Trinity, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're co-equal divine. They live in a, they exist in a hierarchical relation, a hierarchy relationship. So the Father gets the Son, and the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. Jesus is the Son from all eternity. He didn't become the Son at the incarnation. He became the Son of Mary. He became the Son of man at the incarnation. But from all eternity, he's been the Son and the Son of God. Because there are actually people teaching that he didn't become the Son until the incarnation. That's not true. So the incarnation, and I'm going to take you through this, so we have the eternal divine Son, God. He assumed the human nature, body and soul. He's becoming fully man while remaining fully God. There's no mixing of these two natures. So there's a fancy theological term for this called the hypostatic union. In Greek, hypostasis means person, and so it means the union of two natures in one person. Jesus is one divine person with two natures. Human and divine. And so in his full humanity, possesses a human soul and the world. And in the Eucharist, we receive the entire Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. The whole Christ is present in the Eucharist. So Jesus is one divine person who's existed from all eternity, who was sent to human nature. He's got two natures, human and divine. Show you something. We'll see this in Christian art. You'll see in images of Jesus, he'll have three fingers folded down and two sticking up. The three fingers folded down are the Trinity, the three persons of the Trinity. The two fingers pointing up are the two natures of Christ. Because the purpose of icons is also to teach us. There's meaning for, you know, what they have in the icons. And so this is a passage from John. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. We have beheld his glory. Glory is the only begotten Son of the Father. And this is actually, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. This is recited in the Creed, and, you know, we're instructed to bow at this moment. This is in honor of this great mystery. This is a tremendous mystery that sets Christianity off from any other religion. And so this is from Catechism. Believe in the true incarnation of the Son of God is a distinctive sign of the Christian faith. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit which confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God, and that's from John's epistles. The glorious conviction of the church from her beginning, whenever she sings the mystery of our religion, he was manifested in the flesh. So this is the key central of history. And then what's the purpose? You know, why did God come? Well, Jesus actually came to die for our sins, and he couldn't die if he didn't have a mortal body. And so he did this so that we could become children of God, because Jesus is the Son of God by nature, his divine nature, but we become children of God by adoption and grace. When we're baptized, that's when we become a child of God, because then we enter into the life of the Holy Trinity. Because the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within us. Actually, all three persons of the Trinity are in us. And we have that life of grace. We're incorporated into the life of God. We become members of the family of God. And this is St. Thomas Aquinas. The only begotten Son of God, wanting to make us sharers in his divinity, assumed our nature so that he made man, might make men gods. It does mean literally for gods. But it means that we share God's nature by sharing in his grace and in his people within us. And this is from 1 Peter. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, that through these you may escape from the corruption that is in the world because of passion, and become partakers of the divine nature. And so that's what happens when we receive the sacraments, when we participate in well, there's rivers that can move this stuff, but, oh, it's 820. Maybe number 15. So Jesus is a new Adam, the first Adam flunked, he failed, he sinned. And Jesus is the new Adam, the first Adam because he sinned, we all lost sanctified grace. We're all beyond the same original sin, all subject to ignorance of, evil and everything else. The Jesus is a new Adam, perfectly obeyed God, he needs us. So in Adam, we get a death sin, all condemnation, flesh, greater bondage. Jesus, we get life, righteousness, grace, justification, spirit, sonship, and freedom. So, and this is a new creation. This is why we don't worship on Saturday, the Sabbath. We worship on Sunday because Jesus in his resurrection inaugurated the new creation. He's the first one in the new creation. With the new creation, he was resurrected on Sunday. And so the Sabbath is on the seventh day, and Sunday is the next day. So you see eight figures prominently in church designs. You'll see this in our probably a lot of eight-sided. That has to do with the eighth day being the first day of the new creation. So traditionally, a lot of Baptist monks have had eight sides on it because that's when you receive new life, you receive the creation of Christ. So that's what that comes from. Also, Jesus came to reveal God to man. Because remember what happened after Adam and Eve sinned? They were afraid of God, right? They were alienated. And like Neil said, we get distorted ideas of who God is. Sometimes we see him as mean, angry, ogre, or just distant, aloof, he doesn't care. We get all kinds of misconceived notions of God, and Jesus came to show us what God is really like. And so St. John Paul II said, Jesus is the evil face of God and the divine face of God. And so this is from Matthew 2, Dr. Lloyd says, the truth is that only in the mystery of the incarnate word does a mystery of man take on life. For Adam, the first man, was the type, pattern, and was to come, Christ the Lord. Christ, we have the very revelation that the Spirit of Solomon of his love fully reveals man to himself and brings to light his most high calling. And this is St. John Paul II. Human nature, by the very fact that it was assumed, not absorbed in him, has been raised in us also to a degree that we cannot compare. For by his incarnation, he, the Son of God, in a certain way, united himself. Jesus did not become an angel, he became a man. By nature, angels are superior to us, but by grace, in the order of grace, by becoming incorporated in the divine life of the Trinity, we become superior to angels. We are elevated above him. The Blessed Virgin Mary is like the most exalted creature. She's the mother of God, gives her grace, because she's the position that she is in the order of grace. She's above all the angels. Because she is the mother of God, and again, it's by grace. for us, right? So we need to have that willing, that kind of blood, to be willing to die for someone, maybe not physically die for them, but maybe lay aside things we want to do or whatever, to serve them, to help them, to sacrifice others, and that's higher order of love altogether.
Then the incarnation is also a link between heaven and earth. It says that one became a link between heaven and earth, God began to meet here and build each other in praise. In the taking of human flesh, the Father appeared, the Spirit formed it, and the Son assumed it. He who had an eternal generation in the bosom of the Father, now had a temporal generation of time, so he spoke eternal into time. He who had his birth in the middle of him came to be born in the hearts of men. For what would it profit if he was born 1,000 times unless he was born again of the man? But to all who did receive him, to those who have lived in their allegiance, they provide him to my children. So why did Jesus need to die? He really didn't have to die to redeem us. Jesus started redeeming us from the first moment of his conception, his earthly existence. He was redeeming us. He did not have to die to redeem us. He chose to. And one of the reasons is how we know how much somebody loves us is by how much they're willing to suffer, right? If you know if somebody was going to make the right thing for you, you know they love them. But if you know somebody you don't love that much, you're not going to really sacrifice that much. So it shows us in the depth of God's love for us that he's willing to suffer. And again, it also shows he's not willing to, he's not going to make us go for anything he hasn't loved long with, because we're going to suffer all of him. And so he's done that for us. But also, it shows us that death came through a tree, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They ate the fruit, they died spiritually and physically. The cause is made good, it comes from the tree, it's the tree of life. We live each life because of Jesus' life and the cross. So it wasn't absolutely necessary that we had to die, but we chose to die to show the love of his love. And also to establish his kingdom on earth. And this is a passage from Matthew 16, there's a whole lot in this passage, but he says to the apostles, "Who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar Jonah, for flesh and blood is not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter's main change, Peter means rock. And on this rock I will build my church, and the powers of death shall not prevail against it. I will give you," he's talking to Peter, "the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." So this is very clear authority that Jesus has given Peter. This is, in the Old Testament, there was a position of the called royal steward, master of the palace. He was like the assistant to the king in ancient Israel. So if the king was asked, like, his way of war or something, he would literally give, like, a symbolic key to that man to rule the kingdom in his absence. And that's what Jesus is doing to Peter. Jesus is the king to fulfill that Old Testament covenant. And he's making Peter his administrative deputy of his people on earth by giving him the keys. That office has successors. So there's an implication here that there will be successors, because there's going to need to be somebody to run the church on earth until Jesus returns in glory, which he hasn't done yet. And again, the kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. It's in our hearts. It's in the church. Ultimately, it's in heaven. And Jesus, of course, embodies that as a kingdom. So this incarnation now leads us to, why do we have sacred images? Why do we have sacraments? And so in the incarnation, spirit and matter came together again in perfect harmony. Adam and Eve had it initially. They had a spiritual soul, they had a physical body that were in harmony until they sinned. And then once they sinned, they were not, the soul and body were at odds, because, you know, physical desires get in the way sometimes of making what we want spiritually. You know, man's passions and desires are unruly. And so Jesus Christ his divine spirit. And so God gives us grace through his means, not only physical means. He can give it, you know, any way he wants, but he has chosen to give us sanctifying grace through the sacraments, which all of them have a physical, a material component, and then the spiritual component of divine grace. And that's because we are not just divine spirits. You know, we taste the Eucharist, we touch it. We can, you know, we'll get oil, we're confirmed, you know, we can touch it, we can smell it, there's a nice smell. Everything, when we go to confession, we hear the priest say, I forgive you. It's not just, we don't just imagine it, we hear it. Because we need that, and that's why we have images too. When we have, you know, Catholic churches traditionally full of statues and images, stained glass windows, and that's because we need, we're physical people, we need to see things, we need to hear things, we need to smell things. Because, again, we don't worship God with just our souls, we worship God with our body, which is why we genuflect, we cross ourselves. It's all the ways of worshiping God in the totality of the Spirit. And we also see this, in Scripture too, this is scriptural. These are not the only examples, but we see this throughout the Old Testament. There's the bronze serpent, and the Israelites were complaining. God sent these snakes to bite them. They were poisonous snakes. People were dying. So God commands Moses to make a bronze serpent, stick it on the pole, hold it up. Whoever looks on it will be healed. And Jesus says later that, you know, he compares himself as the Moses lifted up the serpent, he would lift it up. Then Naaman was a Syrian military leader who suffered from leprosy, and he had a little slave girl, the Israelite slave girl in his home, who told his wife about Elijah the prophet. And she said, oh, there's a prophet in Israel can heal you. So he gets permission from his king to go to Israel, and Elijah tells him to bathe 7 times in the Jordan River. Well, at first he didn't want to do that, because he's like, oh, we've got better rivers than this in Syria. Because if you look at the Jordan River, it's not a better river. But he does what Elisha told the Ethiopian to swim with his leprosy. And then Elijah's mantle, he takes his mantle, he touches the Jordan River, and it splits apart just like Moses did the Red Sea, and they're able to walk through the river. And then Elisha purifies the poisonous stew with some meal. And then he takes water, bad water, that's been making people sick, and he says, give me a bowl of salt, and I'm going to add the salt to the water, and it will be good. And this is the basis for blessed salt. One of the sacraments we have in our church is the blessed salt. And it's rooted in this scripture passage. And after that, it says in the Bible, the water is good from then on. And then the basis for relics. We have pieces of saints, their bones, their hair, you know, parts of organs. This is the scriptural basis. Here we see Elisha died, he was buried in pain. And it says that there was a man that they were trying to bury him, and these Moabite raiders were coming, and they didn't have time to bury him, so they threw him into the cave where Elisha's bones were, and when he touched the bones, he came back to life. Because again, you know, it's the holiness, the power of God, and the human physically too. And then Christ would heal people just by speaking, you know, he'd say, heal. But also, sometimes, like one person came, a medical case out of the salon, that man was a blind man, and he put it on his eyes, and he said, be healed. And then there was a woman that touched his garment, and she was healed. Again, it showed that connection where the body and the soul and matter and spirit come together. And then in the book of Acts, there were cross that Paul touched, and when people touched them, they were healed. And Peter's shadow, he passed over, so again, we see that connection. And this is the basis that John makes.
No, not that one, but there is a book that was written by a priest, I don't remember the title, but I'll see if I can find out, but it discusses the Greek prophecies. And maybe they'll find them online, if they need it, you know.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. I know this job, explaining something extremely difficult. Thank you so much, appreciate it. Always stand and pray. Bless us, Lord, in these ideas, which we are about to seek in the world, in Christ our Lord. Now, may God bless you. It's true in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise you.
I
And she said,
faith. When I can follow it from the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Many of you have any particular intentions that you want to pray for tonight? Any intentions on people's lives, personality, or religion? Yes, sir.